The appreciation of our environment and the landscape is a key to the writing of profound poetry and creating beautiful architecture. So today I'm going to read an extract of a poem about the Australian bush by poet Henry Kendall. He writes, "Beneath the shades of iron barks, stretched over the valley sloping bed, half hidden in a tree scrub, a flock of dusky sheep were spread. And fitful bleating faintly came on every joyous breath of wind, that up the stony hills would fly and leave the hollows far behind." So the poet has observed the topography as well as how the land is inhabited, as well as the invisible aspect of the environment. So he writes further, "While tones of music from the creek were intermingling with the breeze, the loud rich lay of countless birds perched on the dark mimosa trees. Those merry birds with wings of light which rival every golden ray, outflashing from the lamps of night or streaming over the brow of day." So as you can see, you know, the importance of environment and how this is translated into poetry and how beautifully it's said. And similarly, architects and new budding architects especially need to learn how to articulate the environment through your architecture. So today we have with us Fergus Scott, and he will be talking about five houses and five environments. So I thought, you know, it's very important when we look at a landscape, you know, how the poets observe, especially the Australian poets, and that you similarly do a similar analysis or similar sort of in a poetic way. So Fergus, after graduating from University of Sydney, worked for Peter Strushbury between 1992 and 2000, as well as for Rick Choi in Tuscan, Arizona, and studied the work of Frank Lloyd Wright and the Mayan and Aztec architecture of Central America. Again, the importance of studying the past precedents is sort of is really important. He established a Sydney-based practice in 2000, and it has since built a well-recognized and published portfolio. The work is reflective of each client and responds specifically to each site and its own particular nature. Buildings are operable and engaged with their surrounding, harnessing passive solar and thermal principles from the outset, ensuring continuity and refinement from schematic drawings to as-built detail is central to the process, and it is informed by an appreciation of the value and nature of materials. In addition to projects in central and suburban Sydney, Fergus has completed buildings throughout regional New South Wales. And most of his projects have been well published, and you can look them up. So in his lecture today, he will talk about five houses and the nature of each site and how it has informed a specific architecture and the experiential sensory aspect of the house and how they increase the client's sense of connection with the surroundings. So please all welcome Fergus Scott.
Thanks for coming, lunchtime. Thanks, Nima. Today I'd like to show you five houses, as mentioned, in five different landscapes. How we have sought to identify and respond to the nature of place in each of those designs. How can we value this? Our environment. I can suggest the first step is understanding, understanding going through awareness. The projects that we'll go through are linked by clients who aspire to live with awareness. Awareness of nature, nature of environment, nature of place. This should be equally fundamental in the urban or the landscape context. The first project I'd like to talk about is the Tumble Plains House. And I'm going to show you the sites before the house was built. The houses were built. The Tumble Plains House is on coastal grasslands near Yamba, northern New South Wales. And the client had a long history with the country. It was used for cattle droves and cattle adjustment for 100 years by his family. They used to make camp on the land. And what was interesting about this site was that there was no particular view hierarchy. It was a flat field with all the exposure that comes with that. This is our client. And so when doing a house on a block like this or a site like this, we spent time trying to understand simple things about the pattern of the landscape, how one can inhabit a flat coastal plain which is open to fire, open to wind, open to great solar exposure. Little things might be observed, for example, a small woody melaleuca, which is actually a kangaroo lie. The patterns of vegetation and animal use on the land starts to bring the subtleties of the place to light. Other things that we looked at were previous habitations, typically ephemeral, typically light, typically about retreating from the environment and being inside. Simple batten and board construction, local hardwoods, frogmouth fireplace. Honest small buildings, little cabins on the land, windows particular to environment. The only building on the whole block, which was about 200 acres, was this shed. And what I liked about this shed, which blew over about a month after I took this photograph, was that its mere presence in the landscape started to make a microclimate. I was quite interested in the idea of microclimates. And you can see, just because of the fact that it changed the patterns of water and rain, it was starting to give rise and formed a windbreak. It was starting to give rise to a different layer of vegetation on that grass country. And the inside of the shed too, an internal microclimate with almost a James Tyrrell style roof framing the sky in great contrast to the open plain, and then framing the landscape. There were some spatial cues that came from that with how to live in this country with a sense of containment on the one hand, but a sense of connectedness on the other. If I go back to some travels, if I look at the ancient Mayan city of Palenque in southern Mexico, looking through to the Temple of the Sun, the Mayans were masters of landscape manipulation, and you can see so-called concepts of positive and negative space in these cities. This is an entry point to the Temple of the Sun. This is the Temple of the Cross, and this is, conversely, a courtyard in the Great Palace. So you get this incredible contrast between, in this case, the ruin. Almost the fact that it's a ruin makes it even more powerful as it's becoming enveloped by the landform again, and the negative version of that being the courtyard. So we were thinking about that site, how one might inhabit the plain, and at one stage we thought, well, we do an intervention, well, we do two parallel walls covered with grass to make a microclimate in between, and that would thereby give adequate wind protection for lightweight ephemeral structures, perhaps of the nature of what was previously there. But we took it to a more architectural viewpoint and decided instead to build a pair of parallel walls. So we had two parallel blockwork walls which contain a courtyard room, a roofless room in their centre. At each end was living. One end was living. An enclosed, internalised living space, an open kitchen, a roofless room, and then we've got the bedrooms and the bathrooms at the back. Just some quick construction shots. It's a blockwork building with very light structure in between. So I guess we've interpreted that idea of building protective walls with lightweight structure in between lightweight structure by Professor Max Irvine. The power of the wall, the strength of the wall and the landscape, allowing a sense of connectivity, simultaneously affording protection. And the dynamic reality of this site, grass fires, stronger than you think. And the finished building. So a pair of walls, living between a pair of walls and the open plain. This is the courtyard in the middle of the building. it brings to mind something that I was interested in when I was at uni, which was the application by Grant Hildebrand of prospect and refuge theory to the work of Frank Lloyd Wright, the idea about the basic human psychological tendencies towards wanting to be contained but have outlook simultaneously. And I think that this courtyard expresses that duality. Just some simple shots of the building. These shots were taken by a local bird watcher with 35mm slides at the time, which was a fantastic job, called Lee Pierce. So northern walls, cross walls, lightweight, operability. East-west walls, framing and protecting. Ideas of captured space in the middle of the building, two pavilions. Looking north through the kitchen, we always have a leeward side, or a shaded side, or a sunny side, which basically means the building can be open despite the fact that there's a lot of weather and wind and exposure on this site. The building can be open and people can live on the edges of the building and start to operate the building in accordance with the patterns of the landscape, which is what it's, you know, what the client wanted to be there with his children and family and teach them stuff that he knew about this place. Bedrooms, so you can sleep with doors and windows open but shaded from the summer sun. Western filter and aperture to the outlook. Using battens not as a decorative element really, but as a means of screening the west, such that western light can be a beautiful thing. And most importantly, people, how people use a house and how the use of a house can be something that is in someone's personal history and knowledge bank. Living on the edges of a building. And using that building as a base to be in the landscape around. Simple shots of sky and changing, all taken on the same day. And people again. I really like this. This was to me, it was the gift to the client. It's embroidery, and it's sort of an indication that the house was accepted in the local lexicon, which I was pretty chuffed about. And that's the final shot of the house in the grass. The next project I wanted to talk about is at Gillaby, west of Wyong. Completely different site. Valley floor site, with a steep southern hillside protecting from southern weather. A lot of solar gain on a cleared paddock to the north, and a line of blue gums along a natural watercourse. So the blue gums and the blue gum trunks were quite an important characteristic, and in terms of living amongst the edge of the forest. The forest, by its position and its position running east-west along the edge of the dam, dictated a linear pattern of habitation by people who were staying there temporarily. Basically, people would occupy the northern edge of the tree line in accordance with the daily range and the seasonal range. So we decided to investigate the idea of doing a house which was, in a sense, a series of portal frames, making a veranda along the edge of the blue gums. So the portal frames were a strong structural element, which actually, incidentally, had to be adjustable because there were mine subsidence issues there. And because of this protected hillside, the building could be could, in a sense, be open-sided. So it's almost like a veranda to the forest behind. We moved bathrooms and made it more linear. This is a sort of an earlier installment of the realised plan. And basically a single roof pitching down from a communal area to reduce the scale of living bedroom accommodation on each end of the building. So basically you had a bedroom here, kitchen, dining, living, study, bathroom through the middle. One advantage of this structural approach was that almost in traditional Japanese style, the site was immaculately prepared before the structure was dropped on it. So it was mown. We had large concrete pads, and these precast portal frames were lowered onto the site, and we had good spans between floor structure to let groundwater pass underneath, so we weren't disturbing the natural pattern. And we were just trying to use as much north as we could and just simply respond to the dynamics of sun angles throughout the season. And that's the finished building. Blue gums behind it, a simple canopy structure, offering a protective structure, but also an open-sidedness. Doors and windows planted on the outside of each concrete vertical element and stacking up in front. Looking back to the dam through the central space, looking out to the north and Seoul again through the central gathering space in the building up to the end of the valley. A winter morning scenario later in the day. The centre of the house looking north, open field on one side, Seoul again, the billabong and its detail, and the blue gum forest on the southern side. The nature of the veranda. And also a simple linear arrangement of daily rituals or accommodations, all framed in landscape. And a protective roof. We built a walkway down to a smaller building on the edge of the water because initially there had been a promontory of land that people would go to at a certain time of day, especially at the end of the day, to look at light reflecting over water. And again, people, clients using their house, I'd encourage you all to draw people in your drawings as well. So in a sense, everyone's outside, which I think is fantastic. The house is really a reference point. The house is a storage vessel in this instance, and everyone can sit on the edge of it. The third project is at Fox Ground on the south coast. And again, it's a natural site, but it's been cleared and used for livestock. It's in the remnants of the Illawarra scrub, actually, which was one of the world's great expanses of temperate rainforest. There's still Australian cedar, coachwood, and ficus in that vegetation at the bottom of the gully. How again do we consider building on the side of a hill in a high rainfall area where you get significant overland water flow? How do you live there? This is the north, this little small area of flat land to the north, up into the tail of the gully. This is the southeast, where there's prospect, but looking down to the shoal haven, where in winter you get strong sou'easters belting up the valley. So how do we position a house on a site like that? Again, we sought to understand the weather patterns and how a house might be used on that place. And so what we were considering was on the northern side, can it open up onto flat ground? On the eastern side, can it frame the prospect to the distant rainforest and the valley beyond, but be lifted off the gully to let the overland water flow through? And on the western side, do we filter the sun and provide privacy to the access road behind? So it's a hillside building. How we translated that in this instance was it was a simple arrowhead shape, an L-shaped building, which was lifted off the intermittent gully watercourse on the diagonal running underneath The bedrooms were up on fins and allow the water to run underneath. And again, we've got a screen deck to the southwest, which is a great summer deck. We've got a drawbridge deck almost to the north, which is a great winter deck. I think the idea of having usable connected space on two sides of a living area, so there's always a leeward side, is certainly something that can lend the building a bit more adaptability. And then we've got framed outlook to the distance from these rooms. Translation into the model. This is a blockwork building, thermal mass on the inside, cladding on the outside, and raised floor platform. So this is the finished building, northern side, reaching out onto a flat terrace, mid-slope on the side of the valley. Eastern side, lifting and allowing water to run through. Western side, filtering and giving privacy. Allowing external access to rooms, for all the bathrooms and service rooms can be internally and externally accessed, pointing into the south. Internal, external access, afternoon bathing, living on the corner of the building, lifting up off the ground but connecting with it at one side, opening to the remnant rainforest as an immediate detail. Winter morning. So it's a hillside building. The fourth project is a project that Pete Stutchby very generously offered us to do with him as a joint project. So our office and Pete's office got together, and I notice Larry's here today as well. We got together and did this as a joint project, and that was a really gratifying thing for our office, because we've got a long association with Pete and his studio. Some interesting points about this particular building. It's an estuarine building. It's not an oceanic building. That's the ocean side, hard onshore sou'easters. This is the estuary side, the pit water. Western light over water, offshore breeze, tall, you can see it in the vegetation, tall spotted gum canopy. Whereas the ocean side, you're going to have wind-shaped banks here and an eroded coast. Ideas of classic west shore landscapes sitting against a rock, a warm rock, the filter of the vegetation. These are primal places of inhabitation and historic places of inhabitation. And so our site was bisected by a 6 metre high cliff, which on most adjacent sites, people tended to ignore, and they tended to build atop the cliff and put a big balcony out here with columns, and that became a dead space, and everyone was having their big view of their big western balcony, which is too hot for most of the time anyway. We talked at length about this, and this is a sketch of Pete's, which shows our decision to divide the building into three layers. In a sense, we push the building like a scaffold in front of the cliff face. So the building is a filter to the cliff face, a filter to the sun, and it becomes a veranda to a landscape courtyard behind. So where the house would normally be becomes a landscape terrace, and which would normally be wasted space, the house is outboard and lower of the cliff, which enables the cliff and all its amazing qualities to be incorporated into living into the building. So this is a cliff front building. Some of the schematic plans, how it resolved was basically to have a landscape terrace at the top, The clients wanted ease of access and living up on the top level. So again, it's a veranda space to a landscape behind a landscape or a terrace, a formalised terrace behind in this instance. And then moving down through the building, the next plan at the bottom of the page, bedrooms integrated with the rock, and at the bottom of the page we've got waterfront rooms which engage with the detail of the water. And it was all about management of light as well. Another of Pete's sketches showing ideas of articulation of roof. In Sydney, western light has often been seen as a detrimental thing, but I just think it's the most fantastic thing to deal with. You have to use the form of the building to deal with the light, and what a great way to generate form rather than something that's abstract. And so basically the idea of this was Pete's idea of the fly roof over a lightweight lantern underneath, which imbued, as you'll see, the internal space with the beautiful golden quality of afternoon light, and able to manage the afternoon and imbue its quality into the space. And so this is the house from the street, and so it maintains the views and the prospect out to Pittwater for passers-by. Unlike adjacent properties, you walk down to it from the street. That's the detail of the bay, the tidal bay beyond. During construction, there had been an old building there. The cliff was... This is a priceless element, this cliff. It had been damaged by the old house. It also had active water and clay seams running through it. So how does one take steps to integrate that into a building, even if it's a lightweight building that pins itself precariously to the cliff? It's still got to be very thorough integration. So in some areas, we had to actually cut the cliff and stabilise it. Some areas where it was damaged, we ground it and kept the ground face as part of the interior. And other areas, which would be naturally beautiful afternoon spaces, were incorporated to the inside. So this rock, for example, was directly translated into the lower level bathroom. And we pinned the detail lightly to the rock and separated the house off the rock. And tried to touch the rock in a minimal way. That's the client. All those fantastic clients we've had who have always been such a critical fundamental, obviously aspect of the realisation of all these projects. So engaging with the bay, low tide, were those crabs, and then this is the back of that same room. What we had to do, we had active water running through underneath this rock. It wasn't just a flat face of rock. So we actually built a blockwork wall to retain the clay seam, and we used the cool air that originated from behind the wall off the thermal mass of the rock, and had these brass discs that were at the top of plenum, and the cool air rose up the wall and through this gap up through the building in summer. So these can be open in summer to encourage. And also, you might remember from the plans, we have a central staircase which has hot glass on the top of it on the western side. So you get convection. In a sense, the staircase is a thermal chimney. So we're drawing cool air up from the estuary and the rock face up through the building in summer as required. And this was again just ideas about managing the rock. We had these fantastic old school bricklayers who did the most beautiful organic brickwork to stabilise the rock face and make this all possible for us. And then the different expressions of the rock face integrating it into the interior, so you can really feel the weight of the building as you descend down through it. And the idea of the building being a light frame, really a much more ephemeral structure to the sort of ancient quality of the cliff behind. Just in section drawings, just showing how you integrate the frame. It was a recycled black butt frame with galvanised 10-plate thin connectors at each junction, and it was pinned lightly to the cliff. There's the fly roof above, the dampen on lantern. So in this instance, it's low because we've got a section through a bedroom. This instance, it's tall, because we're just commencing a section through the living room. This is looking the other way. And we have perforated copper screens outboard of the decks. So these are perforated sunscreens, which have a practical purpose, but it goes beyond practical because they imbue the interior with the quality of the afternoon light and give it its nature. And so again, just integrating a building carefully. This path that we're standing on literally becomes a part of the building interior. Black butt frame, as I mentioned, pinned lightly to the rock, with ventilation slots in between. So that's the final version of that stone bench that we're standing on, and moving up through the building. So it's a structure of portal frames. It's essentially a three-story high hardwood building, and then the frame gives way to a series of steel portal frames that support the fly roof over, and then we've got brass fin plates and laminated recycled hardwood shallow vaulted top chord members. This is some shots of the internal space upstairs. So this is the main room as the sun's just passed overhead and it's starting to come in from the western side. And so the fly roof's taken the heat off the building in the middle of the day, but now the damplon's starting to filter the afternoon light as it comes through into the interior, and it's bouncing off the wood. And then there's a datum point, line in the landscape, as Theresa Moller might say, line in the landscape, awning facing west. And the copper screens with their moiré effect filtering the light as they move across each other. So it's an operable building. That's an important aspect about all the work that we're trying to do, is we want to give the clients maximum ability to operate their buildings in a very simple way, in a manual way, and engage and respond to the patterns of the landscape. It's a critical thing. It becomes a daily thing. It becomes a ritualised thing. Brass detail, so no welding or brazing, it's all just folded stuff. So it's using stock sections and bending and folding. That was the aesthetic, and seam matched screw heads. And taking that detail right down to the handles. So just little folded stock square bar, cupboard handles. And then the mid-level. Again, that rocky path we were standing on, and just the engagement with the cliff behind. And then this shot too, as the sun's setting. These guys just love this house. And this is the shot from the road, which you may have seen, which shows the roof becoming a lantern at night. This is the last project I'll show you. This is the South Coast, a beautiful, rare South Coast oceanic hillside. The South Coast is an erosional, exposed landscape. It's oceanic. This is the first hill back from the ocean. And it's Essexite granite, which is probably the hardest granite in Australia. And it's got thin topsoil, which probably wasn't there initially. And the surrounding area, it's granite with basalt outcrops, it's big seas. Further down the coast, it's as I say, it's an eroded ancient coastline. It's almost eroded in an abrasive sense. So with a house like this, materiality is a really important consideration. How do you build in an exposed climate such that a house gains grace in a physical sense with age? And the sort of, as I say, the sort of sandblasted effect that happens to materials in this place. How can you work with that in a way which I guess contributes to the inhabitation of the site. The contrast of light, of heavy and light, light and smooth. The idea of a ship's hull isn't a metaphor for the building at all, form wise. But I like the idea of a ship's hull in the sense of a walled podium, a raised platform that offered simultaneously protection, but a sense of connectivity. Again, the site before the house was built. If you can, and fees and time permit, spend as much time on your sites as you can to try and understand where you'd place the tent. Just simple things. Where would you sit? Where would you pitch a tent? Where would you build a fire? And just be thorough and rigorous in your analysis of the answers of those things. Why do we put the fire there? Why do we put the tents back from the front view edge of the building? Where were we on that site, like the house at Gillaby on the valley floor? Where were we on that site at certain times of the day? What made us be there? Trying to understand the patterns is really important with siting a building. So this building was on the brow of the hill, as the client describes it. And we spent a lot of time taking compass bearings as well, looking at orientations, looking at prospect, visual connection with landscape, which was important, obviously, as a quality of this site, because it's got a 270-degree prospect of the south coast of New South Wales, which is absolutely extraordinary. So we took a lot of time taking bearings, and we did a survey as well. We did our own little survey, which I think was a pretty good learning curve for us. We'd spent some time planning a building on the site. How can you make buildings of separateness or different orientation, enclosed, protected outdoor areas? And in this instance, we followed the contour. So we thought it just made sense on the brow of the hill to follow the line of the hill. So we literally followed the line of the hill. And the reason that this worked on this site, I reckon, was that we were able to point into the prevailing weather. We were able to protect to the east and the primary connection with visual connection with the town and the coast below. We were able to wrap around and give an afternoon protection from the southwest and from the onshore breezes. So that meant, again, like the house at the bottom of the valley floor, simple patterns of inhabitation, which is what we were doing when we were staying there, how you would withdraw into certain areas and then advance in accordance with the time of the day, were in a sense manifested in the plan. So that's the schematic design. And so, again, like the Tumble Plains house, we have a roofless room in the middle, but we also have a protected terrace. As I mentioned, a protected southwestern terrace, which is a really good afternoon space. Documentation showing that sort of compass point and the containment, the walled podium containment. Models, always making models, important to make models. The finished building. In this instance, it's we clad it with this sacrificial core 10 armour. It's like an armoured building, but it's a protective layer, again, with a thermal mass on the inside. So it's really just, it's giving us an air gap and a protection from the weather, which is about patina to an internal thermal mass. And then this central space, which is surrounded by functions. How can you make a central space come to life? How can you make a courtyard space come to life? Well, we can imbue it with the functional requirements of everyday living, and then framing the wall, framing the view to the east, and again this sense of I guess the serenity of protection, but also focusing on the outlook and wrapping the contour of the hill with the building. And this is the northwest terrace in the morning. This is the southern tip of the building pointing into the weather. And one thing to notice about this shot and the subsequent shots, these shots were taken before the landscaping was finished, and you can see the eroded Essex site right up near the surface, and you've got this kind of weedy topsoil, and we thought it would be appropriate in terms of the landscape architectural concept to pursue an erosional strategy. So we actually re-exposed natural rock, and we reused rock on site. And the client spent a lot of time working on these textures and the subtleties of overland water flow after the builder had finished. So the client was responsible for grounding the building with what I thought was a really sensitive landscape, within a really sensitive landscape conceptual framework. So the eastern side of the building, releasing from the edge of the building. Again, the protective walls, the internal spaces. Using light, using orientation, allowing adjustability, allowing movement through a building in accordance with the time of day. It's all about awareness of landscape. And as I mentioned at the beginning of the talk, these sorts of analyses and cues are just as relevant in urban work. It's not just a thing particular to landscape-based buildings. Bedrooms and the privacy of the privacy yet outlooking bathrooms. It's sort of trying to a gradation of intimacy through the buildings. The southern point. The core 10 armour. People using the building, as you've seen before. The texture of the pond, framing and opening, connecting. In a sense, the engagement with this sort of primeval northern eucalypt forest that stretches up the coast is more important than the maritime orientation. So we're trying to sort of imbue qualities of the surroundings into the building, into the use of the building. Layers of landscape, using rock on site, making outdoor spaces in contrast to the interiors. So this is the last shot of that same house. I'll reiterate the importance of clients, and I guess perhaps I'll sum up by giving you a quote that I think you probably all know because it's so well known from the writings of Thoreau, and I think there's perhaps an echo of this in the thoughts of some of our clients linked between these projects, where Thoreau wrote, "I went to the woods because I wished to live deliberately, to front only the essential facts of life and see if I could not learn what it had to teach, and not when I came to die, discover that I had not lived." And that's it.